Australia is the most vulnerable developed country in the world to both the direct and indirect effects of climate change. So you would think we would be at the forefront of trying to fight it. However, thanks to the all-powerful Australian carbon lobby and a series of weak-willed leaders, we are historically one of the worst industrialized nations in combating emissions. And this summer, things are coming to a head. Record heat waves, never-ending fires, cities blanketed in smoke, children evacuating off beaches, people dying in cars trying to escape flames, an incompetent government that won't react. There's a feeling in the air. A feeling that something's got to give. People are angry, and they should be. In this video, we're going to look at who we should be angry at. We're going to go over who knew what they knew, when they knew it, and what they did about it. And when it's done, I'm going to have a beer. We're going to start with the first Prime Minister that we know for sure knew about the existence of global warming, Malcolm Fraser. Fraser is best remembered for being the first Prime Minister to be appointed by the Governor General after a possibly CIA-backed, maybe not constitutional change of power. While the dismissal is what he's most remembered for, he's actually a fairly interesting figure in Australian politics. He wasn't anywhere near as conservative as feared. In fact, he retired his lifetime membership to the Liberal Party after Tony Abbott became leader. That being said, what's his record when it comes to the climate? A lot of the research for this video was done with Hansard. Hansard is the official record kept of all the debates and speeches that take place in Parliament. The Hansard website is searchable by speaker, phrase, date, topic, and more. The good thing about this is we can search to find out when particular terms were first spoken in the Parliament. For instance, terms like greenhouse gas, carbon emission, global warming, climate change, etc. The first of any of these terms to be used in Parliament was the greenhouse effect, spoken by Liberal Senator Don Jessop. During the second reading of the Antarctic Treaty Environment Protection Bill, Jessop read a scientific article so that it might be recorded for posterity.
Much of the carbon dioxide released by burning fossil fuels such as petrol, oil, or coal is eventually dissolved in the oceans. This is most fortunate, for were it not so, the greenhouse effect of this buildup would have led already to the melting of the ice and consequent inundation of much of the habitable world.
This was on the 23rd of May, 1980. This sort of act is important. Thanks to Don Jessop, we have recorded history of someone informing the Parliament of the oncoming danger. At the time Jessop made this speech, the worldwide rate of carbon in the atmosphere was just under 339 parts per million, or ppm. The historical rate of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has fluctuated, but stayed between 200 and 280 ppm between the last ice age and the pre-industrial era. Around 280 is the amount needed to keep the climate at those familiar pre-industrial levels humanity has enjoyed for so long. As fossil fuel pollution rose, the carbon in the atmosphere did as well. So in 1980, when it reached an average of 338.75 at the Mauna Loa station in Hawaii, that was then the highest it had ever been in the common era. The problem with this is that once carbon is in the atmosphere, much of it does not dissipate easily. While the majority dissolves into the ocean over 20 to 200 years, somewhere between 20 and 35% can take hundreds of thousands of years. This is why limiting emissions is so important. It's not just about the immediate future, but the future of all life on the planet. Over the rest of the video, I'll be putting the numbers up on the top of the screen here. We also know that in 1979, the first World Climate Conference in Geneva had expressed concerns over the link between greenhouse gases and climate change. In 1980, the Australian Academy of Science held a conference to review 20 years of measurements showing increasing carbon dioxide levels. So, by then, there was an understanding that the greenhouse effect would result in climate change. This was all under the purview of Fraser's government. However, they didn't do anything. They never had any policy to deal with climate change. They never spoke about it. They just ignored it. Upon Fraser's passing in 2015, several articles were shared about his environmental legacy. This legacy includes better provisions for conservation, more World Heritage sites, and anti-whaling measures in Australia. However, climate change was completely missing. Now, climate discourse wasn't a big thing in the late 70s or early 80s, so no doubt many of you would forgive Fraser for this. However, climate researcher Clive Hamilton found a report made by the Australian Intelligence Gathering Agencies, titled Fossil Fuels and the Greenhouse Effect. This document warned the Fraser government about the possibility of an anti-fossil fuels lobby being born in the late 20th century to protest rising sea levels as a result of global warming. To put it simply, they knew. They knew and they did nothing. Fraser would, later in his life, become an advocate for carbon pricing, amongst other things. And he talked about how the Liberal Party became too extreme, saying,
"I believe that climate change is a reality. The scientists I respect believe it is a reality. And if the science is accurate, we are very foolish not to act. And we are very foolish to say we are not going to act until China and India."
Which is great. But in the earlier stages of climate discourse, when his government could have steered Australia in the right direction, they failed us. After Fraser came Bob Hawke, who was elected in 1983 and was last year eulogised glowingly. What was his government's record? There's a thing called the Australian Conservation Foundation, one of our leading environmental non-profit groups. In the 80s, Joan Staples was their national liaison officer, the one who dealt with the government the most. Joan describes the early years of the Hawke government as lean ones for the environment. She also explains that greenhouse gases were not a priority for the ACF until 1987, when Graham Richardson became the Minister for the Environment. At the same time, opposition member Chris Puplik began to develop a stronger environmental response for the Liberal Party. Staples recommends 1987 as the useful starting date for when both major parties began to take climate change seriously. Again, we know that as early as 1981, the government was aware of the greenhouse effects, and attempts to educate the Australian public actually came as early as the 1970s, in magazines such as Habitat magazine in 1974, and the Canberra Times in the late 70s. Nevertheless, 1987 was when it began to be taken seriously. This tracks with what we can find in Hansard. Australian Democrat Senator Paul McLean mentioned global warming for the first time on record in the Australian Parliament. On Tuesday, the 23rd of February, 1988, he said,
"Most of today's decision makers will be dead before the planet suffers the full consequences of acid rain, global warming, ozone depletion, widespread desertification, and species loss. Most of today's young voters will be alive."
I mean, hey, at least we're not dealing with acid rain anymore. The issue had become so important that in 1989, a poll found that 87% of Australians believed global warming to be a real threat to their lives. The crux of the matter is, any period of feigned ignorance was over. By the year 1989, it was inexcusable not to act on these matters. While announcing the National Greenhouse Advisory Committee, Hawke himself said,
"A great deal is yet to be learned about the greenhouse effect, its timing and impact on different countries and regions. We cannot sit and wait until the effects of global warming are upon us, and then start working on how we deal with them."
So that's what he said, but what did he actually do about it? In 1988, there was a conference held in Toronto called the World Conference on the Changing Atmosphere. There was then a follow-up conference in Ottawa the following year. Two Australian scientists were present and would later advise the Hawke government on the matter. As a result, in late 1990, the Hawke government agreed to a modified version of the findings of that conference. This was to be a 20% reduction on greenhouse emissions by the year 2005 compared to 1988 levels. Speaking about his government's greenhouse targets, he said this,
"So Australians are coming to recognise, as are we all, the dilemma of modern life. We still face the pressing need to feed the people of the world and to create policies that provide the opportunity for growth and prosperity. But in the long term, such economic development is sustainable only if it's ecologically sustainable. Otherwise, the gains made by this generation are achieved only at the expense of those who are as yet unborn."
The only problem is, Hawke completely failed at that goal. The slight modification they made to the Toronto Agreement? It stipulated that Australia should not implement response measures that would have net adverse economic impacts nationally or on Australia's trade competitiveness in the absence of similar action by major greenhouse gas producing countries. Because we wouldn't want to lead on something, would we? Even more staggering is how the government defined harm at this point. According to Guy Pearce, harm was defined by the Hawke government as less GDP growth than they'd assumed. As in, a growth of just 250% by the year 2050 compared to 275%. This would be enough harm for the government to abandon all their goals. It wasn't just a matter of safeguarding the economy against loss, It was about safeguarding the economy for explosive growth. This was the first instance of something that will pop up time after time after time in this video. The Australian government obsessively putting economic interests over environmental ones. Hawke's government promised more than Fraser's, and acknowledged the issue more, but they too offered nothing that would halt or slow the problem. Soon, the recession of the early 90s would give former deputy leader Paul Keating the opening he needed to take control of party leadership. So Keating spoke about climate change more than his predecessor, as the issue continued to gain prominence throughout society. Still, during his 4.5 years at the top, he referred to global warming just 4 times on record, and climate change 12. Not exactly overwhelming stuff. But when he spoke, he did say the right things, such as,
"It is important, not just for the Labour Party, but for the nation, to get these green issues right. Because global warming is here with us whether we like it or not. This will be an important international issue from here on in, and we have a unique opportunity here to preserve our Australian environment, and I want to do that."
And?
"Australia's response recognizes that action must take place within the framework of a sustainable Australian economy and a competitive trade position, as well as protecting the environment."
Like Hawke, Keating's rhetoric put a premium on managing the economy alongside the environment. So how was he? Really, really bad, actually. Staples writes,
"After he became Prime Minister in 1992, Paul Keating actively tried to minimize Commonwealth involvement in environment issues. Soon after he became Prime Minister, the huge Rio Earth Summit on Environmental Sustainability was held, which later evolved into the Kyoto Protocol. 172 governments participated in the summit, and 108 heads of state or government attended, including US President George Bush Sr. However, notably, Australia's Prime Minister Keating chose not to attend."
Earlier we talked about Hawke's caveat that any emissions reduction must not harm the economy. To determine what would or would not harm the economy, the Hawke government created a roundtable discussion group focused on ecologically sustainable development in 1990. This included representatives from environmental groups, businesses, the government, and labour leaders. Some valuable, though hardly revolutionary, recommendations came out of these discussions. Then Paul Keating became Prime Minister. In 1992, former Science Minister Barry Jones spoke out about Keating's priorities as PM. He said the political priorities changed in the government towards focusing on jobs, and that environmental issues were characterised as luxury issues for affluent times. He went on to call this a criminally short-sighted view. Man, if only it was actually criminal. Keating cared very little about the environment or about emissions specifically. Keating's government handed responsibility for the ESD's recommendations to 37 separate interdepartmental committees of federal and state officials. Unsurprisingly, most of those recommendations died in committee. Bergman and Abeyer put it best by saying that the Keating government reversed rather than advanced Hawke's already weak policies. Keating would appear concerned whenever at an international press conference where it was brought up, but he did nothing to confront the problems. Meanwhile, the issue began to become routine in society. People became more used to the threat and less worried about it. That is, until the build-up towards the Kyoto conference, which Keating would not be around for. Paul Keating's government could have built on the mediocre start of Hawke's. Instead, he buried his head in the sand and moved us backwards. 4.5 years of inaction at this juncture was so many million more tons of carbon unnecessarily dumped into the atmosphere, making the problem that much harder for us to fix now. Keating was genuinely as bad on this issue as most of the coalition pigs we're about to talk about. Nothing, though, could prepare us for who was coming next. John Howard. John Howard was Prime Minister from 1996 to 2007. A few of his greatest hits include sending Australia to war in Iraq and Afghanistan, the privatisation of countless publicly owned industries, and a decade-long quest to destroy collective bargaining rights in Australia. It won't shock you to hear that his record on the climate is equally abysmal. When Howard took office in 1996, we were in the lead-up to the Kyoto Conference, the first major agreement on greenhouse gases. So, in his first term, Howard was forced to speak on the issue often. A lot of this section of the video is based on the book High and Dry by Guy Pearce. Pearce was a former speechwriter and consultant to the Howard government on the environment in the late 90s. This book details how, after falling out with the government, he became a lobbyist for different industries. Mining, sugar, timber, and later the environmental lobbies, all the while gradually becoming more and more aware of the power that fossil fuel industries have in Australia. In fact, Pierce undertook a PhD at ANU and interviewed 12 past or present members of the Australian Industry Greenhouse Network, the AIGN. The 12 of these lobbyists were all former bureaucrats or ministerial staffers from the government. One was quoted as saying, "We knew where every skeleton in the closet was. Most of them we buried." Ha! Those little climate rapscallions, killing us all. During all these interviews, Pierce found out that several of these staffers were writing not just briefings for the Howard government, but also ministerial policies themselves. So, fossil fuel lobbies were directly writing Howard's greenhouse press statements and policies. Through his research, Pierce discovered the staggering influence the fossil fuel lobby had over the Howard government. So how did they use that influence? In the lead up to the 96 election, the Liberal Party's stance on climate change was ambiguous. It just wasn't an election issue. But by the time they were in government, negotiations for the Kyoto Treaty had begun. The Howard government, despite having all the information previous governments had, and more, argued that Australia should not cut emissions. Our excuse was that our population was growing much faster, and thanks to our abundant coal resources, we had no economic impetus to do so. Howard related these beliefs in Question Time in September 1997.
"Those who argue that we should be taking a more pro-European stance, those who argue, like the Labour Party, that we should roll over in the face of international pressure, those who argue that we should give in to the most extreme view on this issue are completely ignoring the very drastic consequences that this country would suffer. If we accepted these targets, planned investments in energy-intensive and mineral processing industry in the next 5 years would be threatened, losing the potential, according to the estimates, of some 90,000 long-term Australian jobs."
Again, it's the rhetoric of protecting the economy over the environment, same as Keating and Hawke. When people on the left like me talk about the massive similarities between the two major parties, this is what we're talking about. It's worth pointing out that the job figures Howard presented were unsurprisingly biased. Howard's government claimed that between 90 and 150,000 jobs could be lost through ratifying Kyoto. The most famous jobs forecast that Howard put forth was created by the government's Australian Bureau of Agricultural and Resource Economics, or ABARE, who called their model Megabare. The funding for Megabare came from a steering committee, which cost people or organisations $50,000 to join. Deisendorf points out that every company that joined this steering committee was a greenhouse gas intensive industry, including the Australian Coal Association, BHP, Exxon, Mobil, Rio Tinto, and Texaco. Modelling is only as good as the numbers fed into them. These massive polluters either contributed money so that they might have undue influence, or simply because they knew the government would back up their cause and it was a good investment. Either way, Deisendorf documented the ways in which the government's model put its finger on the scale. For instance, it deliberately excluded cheap and efficient ways of reducing emissions. It ignored the benefits of sustainable energy jobs. And it assumed that even with concerted action by industrialized nations, developing nations could not be convinced to join in lowering emissions. Furthermore, it could only conceive of a carbon tax as the sole way of curbing emissions, while assuming that Australia's gross national expenditure would be hit at least twice as hard as other wealthy nations. Finally, the number of jobs the government feared losing wasn't even true. These would not be 90,000 jobs disappearing, but rather 90,000 jobs failing to materialise, if you believe the numbers, that is. Even if the numbers weren't lies, the jobs they were predicting would mostly be temporary construction jobs. Simultaneously, this claim ignores the thousands of permanent green jobs that would have been created in a better scenario. All in all, the claim that 90,000 jobs would be lost was completely and comprehensively wrong, and you would have to be naive to assume this wasn't a deliberate lie by Howard, his government, and their corporate allies. I would also like to note here, by the way, that perhaps people wouldn't be so terrified of losing their jobs if the Australian welfare state wasn't so deliberately destroyed by the likes of John Howard. Just saying. In the lead up to Kyoto, it was becoming clear that the year 1990 was going to be the base year that the protocols were measured off. This was a problem for Australia, as 1990 represented our peak of land clearance for the era. Allow me to explain. Land clearance is the act of destroying trees to make way for, well, anything. Roads, buildings, mines, whatever. This act releases the carbon that the trees were holding, usually creates emissions through use of machinery to destroy the trees, and removes the trees as potential future carbon sinks. It's a real triple threat of bad. Land clearance had steadily dropped in Australia by 1997, though not due to government interference, mind you. Australia demanded that this dip in land clearance be able to count as cutting emissions, despite the rest of the negotiating parties disagreeing. While cutting land clearance was an unambiguously good thing for the environment, it was not considered the same as deliberately limiting emissions. Only 8 countries even qualified for this proposed land clearance clause, with Australia being the only one that benefited significantly. The rest of the world, desperate to have a unanimous deal, relented and added clause 3.7 to the treaty, which was nicknamed the Australia Clause. Tim Fisher, Australia's then Deputy Prime Minister, was able to secure an incredibly favourable deal for the Howard government. Instead of agreeing to a reduction in emissions or even holding them to then current levels, Australia agreed to keep to 108% of 1990 emissions by the year 2012. Most other countries agreed to at least a 5% reduction on the same levels. In fact, use of the Australia Clause meant that Australia could increase its use of fossil fuels by as much as 30%, while overall emissions would still come in at under an 8% rise. This was perhaps the best deal any industrialized nation got. The result was celebrated by the Howard government, who praised it for, what else? Saving jobs. Clive Hamilton would refer to this outcome as provoking
years of enormous hostility towards Australia for the role we played at Kyoto, where we almost destroyed the treaty at the last moment and extracted a deal seen almost universally as outrageous.
Australia played such a disruptive role that the convention's executive director singled out Australia as the only country not to be committed to the treaty's success. The Kyoto Treaty was signed on the 11th of December 1997, but treaties need to be ratified by a country's own government internally, as well as just being agreed upon by the negotiators. And the Howard government was subject to heavy lobbying by the AIGN Industries, as well as some doubt within the government that global warming was real or needed to be acted upon. Meanwhile, on the domestic front, the first ever package to include funding for the climate came in 1997 as well. It was titled the Safeguarding the Future Package. It was a paltry $202 million dedicated to small regulations and improving energy efficiency. This also included the mandatory renewable energy target, which was aiming to get Australia's energy to be an additional 2% more by renewables by the year 2010. Then in 1999, the Australian Democrats, who held the balance of power in the Senate, were able to secure the Measures for a Better Environment package in exchange for passing the government's GST. This secured almost $800 million more funding. Unfortunately, more than half of this package was to be spent over 4 years on paying for large-scale emissions abatement programs. But it also included $330 million more to renewable energy producers. This was a big win for the Australian Democrats and not in line with what the Howard government or its lobbyists wanted. This was the end of the government's actions on climate funding for quite some time. During this entire 2 year period, Kyoto went unratified by Australia, as debate about it raged. Much of the debate was within the party that signed the treaty, mind you. In August of the year 2000, the Howard cabinet announced that Australia would not begin emissions trading until a global market was already in place. Because hey, no one likes to be the first guest at a party. By 2001, it was clear that Howard wanted to appease the AIGN lobbies and was looking for a way out of ratifying Kyoto, even though the government's goals were aiming to meet the very meager target. According to Pierce's source in the government, Howard sat down for a three-hour meeting with then-new President George W. Bush. In this meeting, Bush outlined why the United States would not be ratifying Kyoto. Instead, their vague plan was to focus on developing new technologies, while completely ignoring emissions targets. Any importance this conversation had was overshadowed by the next morning's events, when two planes crashed into the Twin Towers in New York, amongst other targets. That's right, Howard and Bush had a meeting about the Kyoto Protocols on the 10th of September, 2001. It's kind of remarkable to think about the confluence of those two events and how differently we reacted to both of them. The next two decades will be marked with insane overreactions to the threat of terrorism, costing trillions of dollars and hundreds of thousands of lives, while the reaction to global warming was pitiful. Honestly, it's hard not to look at it as a sliding doors moment for the world. If we'd focused those same resources on the climate, we would be fine by now. But alas, we live in hell world, and Howard enthusiastically allied Australia with the United States. Pierce argues that some of this was to do with Howard's aim to jump the queue to get a free trade deal with the US more than anything else. In November of 2001, then Minister for the Environment Robert Hill, who was in favour of Kyoto, was booted from the ministry. He was moved to the Minister of Defence, where he eventually oversaw Australian troops going into Iraq and Afghanistan. Then, after leaving Parliament, he became Chancellor of my very own university. Awesome stuff. On the 5th of June 2002, which was World Environment Day, Howard was asked once and for all if his government would ratify the Kyoto Protocols. He responded,
"It is not in Australia's interest to ratify the Kyoto Protocol. The reason it's not in Australia's interest to ratify the Kyoto Protocol is that because the arrangements currently exclude and are likely under present settings to continue to exclude both developing countries and the United States. For us to ratify the protocol would cost us jobs and damage our industry."
Howard then called for the world to look beyond Kyoto, mirroring Bush's rhetoric of searching for new technologies. According to him, Kyoto-style targets and timetables don't work, and businesses should have a greater role, though participation should be voluntary. You won't be surprised to hear that that did nothing. While the federal government refused to act, the public's worries about global warming started to increase again. Australia would have to wait until 2004 for any more action on greenhouse emissions, with the 0405 budget and the Securing Our Energy Future policy statement. Between them, they added another $1 billion of spending on climate change. This money, however, was under the new pro-United States anti-Kyoto Protocol of Australian conservative politics. The goals of this money were to pay polluters to pollute less, the typical crap about investing in new technologies that never materialized, and helping to cut down on global emissions by paying to help other countries reduce theirs. While the renewable sector was given an additional $100 million, it came at the expense of the government's own renewable energy target. Though Howard would be in government until 2007, that was the end of their spending on the climate issue. For 11 years in government, during a crucial time in world history, Howard continually reframed the greenhouse emissions debate around the importance of business and the unfairness of developing countries not cutting their emissions as well. This, of course, overlooks Australia's historical emissions and our duty to atone for those. Meanwhile, in the build-up towards the 2007 election, climate change was once again becoming a hot-button issue due to the impact of a severe nationwide drought and years of public build-up. By 2007, a study by the centrist think tank The Climate Institute found that 78% of Australians were very or extremely concerned about climate change. Just 4 years earlier, that number was between 40% and 55%. The opposition, and some of the media, began to grill Howard more and more on the issue. But, more importantly to Howard, the Australian business community did as well. At this point in time, it seemed inevitable that carbon would have to be priced, either through a cap and trade system or through a carbon tax. Not knowing which was coming was leaving investors in the dark. Poor little investors didn't know what was coming. In late 2006, Howard launched the Prime Ministerial Task Group on Emissions Trading, which included members of government and industry. Finally, in April of 2007, after 11 years of downplaying the threat, John Howard announced that the coalition would be bringing an emissions trading scheme into Australia by the year 2011. But this policy ended up being too little, too late. The coalition was decimated in the 2007 election, with much of the commentary being focused on how years of inaction had hurt the government's credibility on the issue. John Howard's record on the climate is atrocious. In 2006, the UNFCCC released estimates for each nation's carbon emissions from 1990 to 2004, but they didn't take into account Australia's phony land clearance exceptions. Over that time, Australia's emissions rose by 25%, the sixth most of any industrialised nation. In that same year, scientists at the CSIRO revealed how they were being censored over presenting global warming research due to government pressure. And while Liberals would brag that they spent $2 billion on climate change over Howard's tenure, 40% of that came from a compromise with the Democrats. Likewise, all of that money was due to be dispensed over a period of 25 years. This averages out to just $80 million a year, which was then around 0.03% of the Australian federal budget. Pierce also points out that the government routinely spent up to 100 times more annually on supporting activities that boosted carbon emissions. For instance, the final Howard budget in 06-07 had $5 billion worth of subsidies for fossil fuel companies and road users. Pierce sums up Howard's energy policies quite elegantly.
All of the Howard government's central claims in defense of its response to climate change are deliberately misleading. They disguise the real intention of the current approach: to quarantine Australia's emissions from attention, to allow them to rise, and to avoid the polluter paying for as long as possible. At the same time, the government seems intent on further entrenching Australia's position as an exporter of fossil fuels and greenhouse emissions.
John Howard was an honest-to-God ghoul. He was a shockingly irresponsible global actor, and the main reason Australia has historically lagged behind the rest of the world when it comes to the climate change issue. The man should honestly be in prison, and when he dies, I'm throwing a street party, and you're all invited. Just kidding. John Howard's never dying. Along with workplace relations, climate change is one of the biggest issues of the 2007 election. An election that Rudd would win in a moment I still remember. It was a moment where change felt like it was in the air, and after so many years of inaction or regression, that something would finally get done. See, Kevin Rudd famously made this statement regarding climate change before the election.
Climate change is the great moral challenge of our generation. Climate change is not just an environmental challenge. Climate change is an economic challenge, a social challenge, and actually represents a big challenge on the overall question of national security.
In fact, he liked that quote so much, he would use that phrase again 2 years later in front of the UN.
The South Pacific is a part of the human face of climate change, and that's why Australia, nationally, regionally, and globally, stands ready to play its part in acting on the great moral, environmental, and economic challenge of our age.
So hey, he was a guy who understood what was at stake. So what would he do about it? In a deliberate symbolic gesture, Rudd had his government ratify the Kyoto Treaty on the 3rd of December, 2007, claiming it as the first official action of his government. It's worth pointing out that this ratification was still of the shockingly unfair deal that the Howard government secured, but it was still seen as a step in the right direction of proving that Australia now took climate change seriously. While still in opposition, Rudd commissioned a report on climate change by Professor Ross Garnott. Garnott was a previous economics advisor to Bob Hawke, during Hawke's inactive period on the climate, no less, as well as an ambassador to China, amongst other things. It's worth noting that Garnott is an economics professor, and the main goal of this review was to assess how Australia could both survive the global climate apocalypse while maintaining as much of our current neoliberal economic policies as possible. After Rudd was elected in 07, the plan was still to wait for the Garnott review, which was eventually published on the 30th of September 2008. The Garnott Review had a dual focus. It existed both to advise the Rudd government on the best method to deliver emission cuts, while also advising what levels Australia should be pushing for at the upcoming Copenhagen summit. The amount that Australia would agree to cut would be tied to what the rest of the world agreed to. As such, the review based its findings on the supposition that the world needs to keep greenhouse gas concentration to between 450 and 550 ppm by the middle of the 21st century. It recommended that Australia have two targets to take to Copenhagen. The first target was to aim for the lower end, an attempt to keep greenhouse gases to just 450 ppm, with the acknowledgement that the world would probably still overshoot this figure. In order to do this, Australia would agree to cut emissions by at least 25% by the year 2020 based on 2000 levels, and by 90% by the year 2050. Garnaut acknowledged the difficulty in getting all parties to agree to this, so the report also recommended a secondary target, attempting to get the world to agree to a cap of 550 ppm. In order to do this, the report recommended that Australia agree to cut emissions by at least 10% by 2020 and 80% by 2050, again based on 2000 figures. This was essentially the backup figure. In the event that this too fail, Garnaut recommended Australia cut its emissions by 5% by 2020 on 2000 levels, regardless of what takes place. The review recommended an emissions trading scheme as Australia's best way of achieving these cuts. The review also called for more funding for climate science research. And finally, it recommended how best to distribute the money from sale of carbon permits. It said to focus on households who might be harmed by the policies, and that while most businesses who clamoured for assistance should be met for scepticism, relief should also be given to areas that would find it difficult to transition to a low emissions economy. The Garnaut review was far from perfect. Guy Pearce talked about how it didn't have enough of a focus on wind and solar power. Climate researcher Clive Hamilton derided it as well, especially the publication of the fallback plan. After all, what use is negotiating when the rest of the world knows your fallback? Hamilton also pointed out that to get down to the backup level of 550 ppm, while Australia would only have to cut its emissions by 10%, other nations would have to cut theirs by far more. For instance, Canada by 33%, Japan by 27%, and so on. Going by Garnaut's fallback plan, we were once again asking the rest of the developed world to bear a much larger share of the burden, while ignoring our historical contributions to the climate. The Rudd government tried to install the ETS as part of the larger Carbon Pollution Reduction Scheme, or CPRS. While the Garnaut review was not perfect, the CPRS fell short of even these goals. The CPRS was to contain a cap-and-trades emission trading scheme, with the aiming start date of 1st July 2010. Essentially, the government would announce the limit for each year's total emissions, at least 5 years in advance, then businesses would be required to purchase permits for every ton of CO2 they emitted. These permits could be bought from overseas countries with ETSs as well, if they couldn't be found in Australia. The initial ETS would cover around 1,000 Australian companies, although emissions from transport, industrial processes, waste, and fugitive emissions, such as in oil and gas production and agricultural practices, were to be excluded from the ETS until at least 2015. So the ETS was deliberately excluding a lot of the largest polluting industries for the first 5 years. In addition, it specifically outlined $7.4 billion worth of free credits in the first 2 years for emissions-intensive trade-exposed industries, also known as EITEs. EITEs are composed of fun little high-polluting businesses like glass production, paper and cardboard manufacturing, methanol production, carbon black production, and aluminium smelting and refining. This was something that the all-knowing, all-wise Garnaut review said specifically not to do. Oopsie whoopsie! On top of that, the government was set to provide $3.9 billion in free permits to coal-fired electricity plants in the first 5 years of the scheme. The Rudd government's argument was that these free permits were to assure that these EITEs wouldn't be so harshly punished that they would move offshore. The act of high emissions industries leaving to other countries is called carbon leakage. Garnaut highlights this as one of the main reasons that a comprehensive worldwide agreement is needed, so that one country can't just hoard all the high-intensity industries. By paying their permits off, the government essentially ignored this, and safeguarded those industries anyway, despite the fact that 16% of all energy emissions in Australia come from aluminium smelting and refining alone. The aim of the cap ended up being slightly higher than Garnaut's backup figure, coming in at 15% on 2000 levels, so long as other countries around the world pledged to do the same thing. They also put in the absolute minimum of 5%. The Greens criticised the CPRS's modest targets and exemptions for big polluters. they were in favour of a 40% cut of emissions. To which Rudd would say,
"There was no scientific justification for a 40% cut. They just knew it was 15 to 20% higher than anyone else was prepared to offer. They designed it in a manner to cause the negotiations to fail. The negotiations with them were a bullshit exercise."
You know, I was trying not to swear in this video, Kev, so that, you know, family-friendly or whatever. Kid. It's almost like Kev doesn't understand that sometimes you bring a higher target to a negotiation in order to be worked back down to what you actually want. We don't all just publish our fallback plan, Mr. 07. Nevertheless, to get this plan through the Senate, Kevin needed either the support of the Greens and two independents, both of whom opposed the CPRS, or the support of the Coalition. Leader of the Coalition's little brother party, the Nationals, Barnaby Joyce, announced that the Nationals would not be supporting the CPRS no matter what. While the legislation was being readied, Malcolm Turnbull became the leader of the Liberal Party. Turnbull was on record as being in favour of an ETS, adding an interesting dimension to the issue. However, he was not in favour of the plan as it existed. Rudd's situation was this. The ETS he wanted to pass, as watered down and mediocre as it was, did not have the votes to pass through the Senate. Fortunately, the Australian Parliament has a fun little mechanism for situations like these, the double dissolution. If a bill passes through the lower house and is rejected by the upper house, the government can once again submit it to the upper house. If it's then rejected by the upper house again, the government can call for a double dissolution, whereby both houses of parliament are dissolved entirely by the Governor General, and a full election is held for all 150 seats in the lower house and 76 seats in the upper house. A government can do this if they believe a bill is that important and want to fight over it, or they could also do it if they believe they are in a strong enough position electorally that it will bolster their numbers in both houses. So, Kevin had a few obvious options. He could A, submit his own ETS, get rejected twice, and call a double dissolution. In theory, this could have given Labor control of the Senate if the election was to turn out brilliantly. This would probably have resulted in a friendlier Senate, but likely still would have gotten the Greens the balance of power. We're playing historical what-ifs here, so who knows? In theory, Labor could have won 37 seats in the Senate and passed whatever they wanted. We don't know. Kevin also could have chosen B, to work on a more eco-friendly ETS and earn the Greens' support. Then they would have let the Senate reject it and again call a double dissolution. In this scenario, even if the Greens did hold the balance of power, it would be enough to get the ETS through. Or he could go with C, the least risky path. He could negotiate with Malcolm Turnbull and further water down the ETS in an attempt to get it through the current sitting Senate with support from the Liberals. Kevin Rudd chose to negotiate with Malcolm Turnbull. After negotiations, the bill was watered down again in a multitude of pro-business ways. For instance, the ETS was to be delayed an extra year to 2011. The carbon price was to be just $10 a tonne in the first year, instead of the projected $25, before becoming market-based after that. There were to be even more free permits for EITE businesses, covering up to 95% of their emissions early on. They were to double the assistance to coal industries. And they added an extra $1.5 billion to offset power price increases for manufacturing businesses. All of this, instead of just a simple carbon tax. In the end, this bloated abomination passed the lower house, but it was defeated in the Senate on the 13th of August 2009. This happened because Malcolm Turnbull couldn't convince his party room to support the policy that he negotiated. That right there should have been a hint that if he were ever to become Prime Minister, he wouldn't get anything done. That right there. Damn, I'm getting ahead of myself. The Senate rejected the bill a second time on the 22nd of October 2009, granting Rudd the double dissolution trigger. One small victory for the Rudd government at this time was the passing of the renewable energy target. The RET mandated that at least 20% of the country's power be renewable by the year 2020, and we actually passed that this last year, despite everything you're about to hear about. Small victory. After the ETS was rejected by the Senate twice, the government called on the Coalition to negotiate in good faith, saying they would reintroduce the bill again before that year's Copenhagen conference in December. The Liberals returned to the negotiating table, securing even more support for businesses. For instance, agricultural businesses, a huge pollution sector, was to be excluded from the ETS indefinitely. On top of that, electricity generators would gain another $4 billion in free permits over 10 years. And another $1.1 billion was to go to mining and manufacturing companies to cope with power price increases. All this, by the way, was accompanied with $5.67 billion less compensation to households. Beyond satire. Turnbull and his shadow cabinet agreed to those terms, but when he took it back to the party room, the Conservatives threw a hissy fit. A week later, Tony Abbott was named Liberal Party leader after winning the second round of voting 42-41. Just one vote. Tony's reformed hard-right Liberal Party rejected the renegotiated ETS, giving the Rudd government another double dissolution trigger. All they had to do was resubmit, let it get rejected, then call the double dissolution. Instead, Kevin said this.
I've said consistently, going back a long, long time, that my belief is the Australian people expect us to fill a full term. My view on that has not changed.
This is a truly bizarre statement. Of course there's an expectation that a government would fulfill its term, but the Australian public also expected the government to pass meaningful climate legislation. They had to choose which expectation to let down, and they chose what they believed was in their own best interest. Rudd's final ETS was a pathetic, watered-down version of an already watered-down initial plan, based on a watered-down report by an economist. It would have solved nothing and helped very little. And that's not just my opinion, by the way. It's also the opinion of climate researcher Dennis Woodward.
It was successfully watered down to appease the vested interests of polluting industries. To extend that its usefulness in combating climate change was doubtful.
On the international front, Rudd would eventually take his plan to the much-publicized Copenhagen summit in 2009. The Copenhagen conference was a much-hyped event, with a particular media focus on the significant role Rudd was expected to play. I mean, even the New York Times got in on the act. If the conference was a success, Rudd could expect a lot of praise. The talks were a disaster. Some faults should lay at the feet of the Obama administration, who came to the table offering a pathetic cut of just 4% based on 1990 levels. This is while the Democrats controlled both houses of Congress, by the way. The chief negotiator for a group of 130 developing countries called this nothing short of climate change skepticism in action, and said that Obama had eliminated any difference between him and Bush. An absolute king. More like Lumumba D a king, am I right? At the end of the conference, countries agreed to take note of, not adopt legally, but take note of the conference's recommendations, where no emissions reduction target was set. Broadly speaking, this did not present Kevin Rudd with the international mandate he'd hoped to attain to shame the Liberals into action. The ball was still in the air. In early 2010, the government attempted to reach a compromise with the Greens, Independent Senator Nick Xenophon, and a couple of Liberal senators who had crossed the floor. Bringing together this motley crew, of course, failed. Then, on April 27th, 2010, Rudd announced he was shelving plans for the CPRS until at least 2012, after the world's Kyoto commitments had lapsed, as
the opposition decided to backflip on its historical commitment to bringing in a carbon pollution reduction scheme. There has been slow progress in the realization of global action on climate change. These two factors together inevitably mean that the implementation of a carbon pollution reduction scheme in Australia will be delayed.
So much for the great moral challenge of our lifetime. Many have pointed out that the recovery from the global financial crisis was so important that people simply didn't care as much about climate change. But that isn't quite accurate. Bergman and Abeya point out that a poll came out on the exact same day as Rudd's announcement. This poll noted that 72% of Australians believed we should take action on global climate change before an international consensus was reached. To put it simply, people can care about more than one thing at once. The feedback to Rudd's betrayal was quick. A news poll taken a week before the announcement had Rudd's favourability at 50%. A week after the ETS backed down, it had slid down to 39%, the second largest fortnightly drop in the history of the poll. In fairness, there were a few other things going on as well. Mining corporations were in the middle of a massive campaign against the government's mining tax, for instance. This could have been the final straw among many. But boy, was it terrible. Rudd to this day still disputes these records, going as far as to send a pathetic letter to Jacobin about it in November of 2019. Kevin, mate, just a little tip. If you're gonna send a pissy letter to a media organization, don't sign it with your former job title like that. It just makes it sadder. Also, you're a despicable failure, and one day I hope you're able to reckon with that. I kind of love this letter though, because it shows you exactly who Kevin Rudd is. For instance, he writes about the option of the double dissolution still being open to the very day that Julia Gillard and her co-conspirators knifed him, which completely goes against what he said in 2009 when he got that trigger. We have records, dude. You can't just make it up. Kevin Rudd is a smarmy prick who thinks he's a hell of a lot smarter than you. Instead of standing for any apparent beliefs, he bent to the will of capital and let down anyone who voted for his party. In response to Rudd's letter, Jacobin published a piece by Greens MP Adam Bandt, who, while dunking on Rudd, goes on to praise the next Prime Minister, Julia Gillard. Which, well, let's talk about her now. After she became PM in 2010, Gillard's government was returned to power with minority government. That is, both Labour and the Coalition failed to gain the 76 seats needed to form government, and had to convince the five remaining minor party and independent MPs to support them. Gillard succeeded, allowing her to form minority government. In the Senate, the Greens won a seat in every state, giving them the full balance of power they lacked under Kevin Rudd's term. Anything Gillard wanted to pass would have to go through the minor parties in the lower house, then gain approval from the Greens in the Senate. Negotiation with the Coalition was more or less off the table for everything, with Tony Abbott securing his position as opposition leader. Now, if we lived in a sensible country, the Greens' beliefs would be the mainstream centre-left. But we don't, so to a lot of people, they're godless communists. During the 2010 election, the Coalition called for a $3 billion direct action fund, essentially the same pork barrel spending the Howard government pulled in the late 90s. The Gillard climate plan, however, was not super specific. First, they promised a citizens' assembly on the issue, to try and ask regular Aussies to come in and come to a consensus, in a plan that was widely mocked. Then came the infamous comment in the final weeks of the election.
There will be no carbon tax under the government I lead.
In her autobiography, Gillard explains the infamous carbon tax lie was because she forgot to give the second half of her answer, that she would not have a carbon tax, but might do an emissions trading scheme. Later on in the campaign, she's on record saying,
I don't rule out the possibility of a CPRS, a market-based mechanism.
But which of those quotes do you think Tony Abbott and the media focused on? That was the extent of climate policy they brought to the election. In order to form minority government with the Greens, the Labour Party agreed to develop a climate plan together. According to her autobiography, Gillard claims the Greens were arguing for a 40% reduction on emissions based on 1990 levels, something that would have been genuinely amazing. Gillard instead points out that this is what held them back from negotiating with the Rudd government. Similarly, during negotiations, the Greens said the price for carbon should start at $60 per tonne, then fell back to $40 per tonne. Julia got them down to 23, closer to the level that the EU was at. Of course, then the Eurozone crisis happened and some countries were selling carbon for as low as 2.63 euros per tonne. And that right there might be a simple argument for why a carbon tax is more effective than an ETS. Markets can be volatile, especially multiple worldwide ones. Regardless, in February of 2011, Gillard announced the plan with the Greens was to create a carbon price for Australian businesses, to later be replaced by a full emissions trading scheme in 3 to 5 years. Right away, a fuss was stirred. After all, the one thing she promised was there would be no carbon tax, and carbon price sounds pretty close to carbon tax. Radio host Alan Jones held Gillard for a contentious interview the next day. He asked her about the white-hot anger out there, about her going back on her word, and Gillard responded.
In the last election campaign, I talked consistently about how climate change was real, it was caused by human activity, that we needed to cut down on carbon pollution, and that the best way of doing that was to price carbon through a market-based mechanism. And that's what I announced yesterday. I announced that there would be a fixed price for the first few years, and rather than play any semantic word games, that is, a market-based mechanism, but rather than play any semantic word games, I was frank enough with the Australian people to say that the first few years would work effectively like a tax.
Indeed, the difference between a carbon tax and a carbon price is somewhat semantic. A carbon price is charging polluters X dollars per ton of carbon they pollute, whereas a carbon tax would be charging big polluters X percent of money they earned compared to how much they pollute. In effect, they do the same thing. Gillard's idea was to lay this out to the electorate and to the media and hope they would understand. It didn't work. She would later in 2013 write,
I erred by not contesting the label tax for the fixed price period of the emissions trading scheme I introduced. I feared the media would end up playing constant silly word games with me, trying to get me to say the word tax. I wanted to be on the substance of policy, not playing gotcha. But I made the wrong choice, and politically, it hurt me terribly.
The carbon price was passed as part of the larger package with the ETS to come in later. 500 big polluters were to be charged $23 per tonne in 2012-13 and $24.15 per tonne in 2013-14. The government acknowledged that this would lead to a rise in energy costs, as the energy companies would be taxed under this scheme. To combat this, the tax-free threshold was raised, and there was a plan to grant tax cuts to households below 80 grand a year. Of course, the Labor government also opened up the bill to industry. So, $9.2 billion were to go to EIT industries. Heavy polluters like steel, aluminium and pulp got free permits covering up to 94.5% of their emissions. $1.2 billion was allocated for a clean technology program for manufacturers. Also, agricultural emissions were made exempt. Some money was put aside for greener measures, though it was still large amounts of money going to industries. For instance, $1.3 billion was to assist coal miners in finding alternate employment. $10 billion was set aside for the Clean Energy Finance Corporation to invest in renewables. And $3.2 billion was held back for research and development. Much of, if not most of this money, would have flown into the private sector. It just would have been the green private sector, as opposed to the emissions-intensive private sector. The majority of this scheme was about paying big polluters not to pollute, while putting aside some money for renewables. It was neoliberal capitalism in the same vein of Kevin Rudd and John Howard, just with a little bit more on the environment on the side. Tony Abbott called this socialism, masquerading as environmentalism. The Energy Users Association of Australia, in its June 2013 paper, said that electricity generators were able to pass through more than 100% of the cost of the carbon price. To rephrase that, the electricity companies made money off of the panic spread by the Murdoch media and Tony Abbott. Just awesome stuff. Just a great system that we live under. The carbon price was a contentious issue for Gillard's entire prime ministership. The far-right media attacked her over it constantly, and any level of popularity or trust she had among the voters was destroyed. Gillard's plan came under criticism from the left as well. Writing for the website Green Left, a site you should absolutely be following, Peter Boyle pointed out that the government's carbon price modelling assumed that coal production would rise between 109 to 105% by the year 2050. He also pointed out that a scheme which had the support of the majority of Australian capitalist economists was one that would benefit the industry at large over the environment and workers. Simon Butler, also writing for the Green Left, pointed out that most of the emissions cuts predicted under the scheme wouldn't take place in Australia. Instead, they would take place in poorer countries where many of the carbon credits would be purchased from. All in all, Gillard's plan was severely flawed. Like I said, it had its share of problems, and it's incredibly important that we acknowledge that. But electricity emissions in the last year of carbon pricing went down. These accounted for about a third of Australia's total emissions. In the 2012-2013 financial year, they accounted for 550.2 million tonnes. And in the following financial year, that was reduced to 542.6 million tonnes. In fact, emissions were down across the board, except for fugitive emissions. Personally, I kind of hate that Gillard gets deified by Australian centrists in this regard. Gillard herself admits that in some respects, her deal was more conservative than the CPRS that Rudd wanted to pass, and that she was fortunate that Greens leader Bob Brown was nearing the end of his career and willing to settle. But this is one of the few tiny victories in regards to the climate that Australian environmentalists can point to. It's incredibly sad that this is our starting point in combating CO2 emissions. It was decades later than it should have been, and nowhere near enough. But to this day, we still cling to it, because it's all we have to point out that was positive. Because the next year, it would be repealed by the brand new Abbott government. So Kevin Rudd, of course, came back into power for Gillard in the dying minutes before the election. The Labour Party was still swept out of power. Abbott's policy during the 2013 election was again that same $3 billion direct action fund to pay industries to pollute less. It was widely derided by reasonable figures in the media and environmental groups, and of course this didn't matter. Before we go into Tony's history, I want to talk a bit about what his beliefs are, because what he says about them changed often. For instance, in his 2009 autobiography, Abbott wrote,
"It sounds like common sense to minimize human impact on the environment and to reduce the human contribution to increased atmospheric gas concentrations. It doesn't make much sense, though, to impose certain and substantial costs on the economy now in order to avoid unknown and perhaps even benign changes in the future."
However, according to Errington and Van Olsen, Abbott was on the record as musing about a carbon tax being a simpler alternative to the artificially created markets inherent to emissions trading. And on the eve of the 2013 election, he would say on ABC TV,
"I think that climate change is real. Humanity makes a contribution. It's important to take strong and effective action against it, and that is what our direct action policy does."
Then, when in government, he said,
"If I may, for the benefit of the member, say the government accepts that climate change is real and that humanity does make a contribution, but the important thing is to take strong and effective action to deal with it."
But in 2017, when he was on the backbenches, he famously said,
"It's climate change policy that's doing harm. Climate change itself is probably doing good, or at least more good than harm."
So which of these takes does he actually believe? Malcolm Fraser said it best when he said,
"But hasn't Tony Abbott had several different views? So who's to say he won't have one or two more before the end of the day?"
Personally, I don't think Tony Abbott believes any of them. Tony Abbott is not a simple climate denialist. His ideology is that of a hardcore Catholic social conservative. Everything else he says comes down to what he thinks is more politically expedient at that moment, whether that means calling climate change real as PM or calling it fake as a backbencher. But at the end of the day, when you're Prime Minister, what you say about the climate doesn't matter nearly as much as your actions. And Tony Abbott's actions were that of a rabid climate change denialist. One of the first things the Abbott government did was ditch the Ministerial Portfolio of Science. Then in the 2013 UN conference in Warsaw, Australia sent no minister to represent the government. Another early act was to dismantle the Climate Commission, which existed to provide advice on climate science to the government. And eventually, the Emissions Reduction Fund was founded in December 2014 after the government officially did away with the Gillard Carbon Price and Future ETS plan. The amount of money for the fund ended up being just $2.55 billion in the end. We will go deeper into Tony's Direct Action Fund in a bit, since it comes back. Like I said earlier, the final Gillard year marked a downturn in carbon emissions for energy. What happened under the Abbott government? A great artist once said,
"Men lie, women lie, numbers don't."
And to an extent, that's true. But the way we choose to interpret those numbers, how we frame them, is incredibly important. The Abbott government understood this better than most. For instance, the Abbott government's 2015 target for the year 2030 was to reduce greenhouse emissions by 26 to 28% off of 2005 levels. That sounds great, right? 26 to 28% less? That's a huge number. Well, the aim was to be better compared to 2005 levels, when we were already polluting way too much, instead of levels based off the year 2000 or 1990. 1990 being an important year because that's what Kyoto Protocol agreements were based on. If we were to compare the Abbott government's goals from 1990 levels instead of 2005 levels, it would alter emissions by somewhere between 5% less or 5% more of 1990 levels of greenhouse gases by the year 2030. Think of it this way. If I drink 15 beers one night, then say the next day that I'm going to cut my daily drinking by 20% based on the last 24 hours, I'm still going to be getting pissed that night, aren't I? No, not yet. This is just what the Abbott government said they wanted to do, not what they actually did. The same report informs us that Australia had the largest gap between their then-current target and their then-current projections. With those policy measures, Australia's emissions were set to increase to more than 27% above 2005 levels by 2030, instead of decreasing by that same number. If we were making that equivalent to 1990 levels, that would be an increase of 61%. The report also says that had we kept our nascent carbon pricing system, Australia is projected to be 5% above 2005 levels instead. So, even with the pathetic target his government took aim at, they were never anywhere close to being on track for it. And, after replacing Gillard's heavily flawed policy with no real policy at all, emissions once again began to rise. Despite all of this, Australia would agree to the Paris Agreement during its drafting phase in April 2015. Abbott would later go on to say that he was actually misinformed by his advisors and did not support it. Then, when he was facing a challenge from a climate change-believing independent conservative in 2019, he flipped again and said it was a good thing. Just a man of many beliefs. We'll get more into the Paris Agreement in a second. Abbott would eventually be replaced within his own party due to his staggering unpopularity and a series of broken promises. But before we move on to Turnbull, I want to leave you with one last Abbott quote, one that's been on my mind this entire fire season. During his 2017 speech that suggested that climate change could be doing more good than bad, he said,
"Contrary to the breathless assertions that climate change is behind every weather event in Australia, the floods are not bigger, the bushfires are not worse, the droughts are not deeper or longer, and the cyclones are not more severe than they were in the 1800s. Sometimes they do more damage, but that's because there's more to destroy, not because their intensity has increased."
Tony Abbott's reality is his own, one formed by ideology and protected by some sort of weird narcissistic mania. During this recent crisis, I've seen minor bits of Abbott apologia pop up around the net, people calling Morrison worse, or saying at least Tony Abbott had beliefs. And I'm here to tell you, no, none of these guys are better. They are all unequivocally horrible. Tony Abbott may piss on you if you're on fire, but he'd never admit to starting that fire himself. So our only mention of Turnbull in this video so far came from his negotiations with Rudd as opposition leader in 2009. By 2015, he'd worked his way back to leader, now as the Prime Minister. However, the party had been dragged so far back towards the right during those 6 years. The thing is, Turnbull wasn't brought in to be a reformer. He was brought in because Abbott was shockingly unpopular, and Turnbull had the best name recognition in the rest of the party. He had smartly opposed some of Abbott's least popular ideas, but his attitude on climate change was not part of the leadership challenge. But as you may remember from earlier, Turnbull was in favour of an ETS, going as far as agreeing with Rudd's 2009 package. So what did he do as PM? Turnbull had Australia ratify Abbott's Paris Agreement commitments on the 10th of November 2016. The Paris Agreements were different to past deals, where specific percentages and reductions were the aim. The Paris Agreement instead said that nations would do all they could to keep the global temperature rise to just 2 degrees compared to pre-industrial levels, or ideally 1.5. The weakness of the Paris Agreement, and perhaps the reason it was so readily agreed to, is that each country may set their own contribution. The agreement just requires them to be ambitious and progress over time. There's actually no mechanism in the treaty to force a country to meet any of its targets. It's all non-binding. So if anyone tells you that this is all a scheme by the UN trying to take control of the world, it's a pretty bad way of getting it done. At the press conference after ratification, Turnbull said,
"The Australian government today reaffirmed Australia's strong commitment to effective global action on climate change. Ratification of the agreement confirms Australia's ambitious and responsible target to reduce emissions by 26 to 28% below 2005 levels by 2030.
Of course, this was neither effective action, nor ambitious, nor responsible. This was the same target that Abbott used, which would get Australia nowhere near the 1.5 to 2 degree cap that the Paris Agreement demanded. Well, not demanded, more like politely requested. Adding to that was the fact that we still weren't on track to meet that pathetic, limited goal. At the 2016 elections, the Liberals did not have a new policy on the climate. Again, it didn't matter, and they won re-election by a hair. After Paris's ratification, Coalition Energy Minister Josh Frydenberg announced that the Coalition would consider a limited form of carbon pricing for energy companies as part of a review of Australia's climate policy. This announcement came on the 4th of December, 2016. 3 days later, Turnbull repeatedly said in a press conference that the government would not put a price on carbon before the next election. He said,
"We will not be imposing a carbon tax, and we will not be imposing an emissions trading scheme. However it's called, an emissions intensity scheme is an emissions trading scheme. That is just another name for it. That has been our policy for many years now."
Just the mere mention of a carbon price being considered by a review was enough to send the coalition's conservatives into a tizzy, forcing Turnbull and Frydenberg to back down before they'd even started. The next year, the government commissioned a report by Dr. Alan Finkel, Australia's chief scientist, a real-life government position that exists. Finkel's report was termed the Clean Energy Target. The report focused on promoting security and reliability, as well as lowering emissions. He had the same 28% of 05 level goals as the previous and current Liberal governments. So the Finkel review had its mixture of good and bad. It had more stringent rules for how efficient coal power plants should be, but was still limited by its pathetic goal. The Guardian helpfully pointed out that if policies stayed the same, Australia would be producing 57% of its energy by coal in 2013. Under Finkel's CET, that would instead be likely to drop to 53%. Ross Garnaut criticised the plan as nowhere near as helpful as his proposed ETS was. Remember Garnaut? From like an hour ago in this video? Simpler times. Still, this was too much for Turnbull's party. From the backbench, Tony Abbott argued that this would be a tax on coal, and much of the party agreed with him. The cabinet rejected the clean energy target portion of the report and began working on their own plan. In late 2017, the introduction of the National Energy Guarantee, the NEG, came. The NEG would require power companies to use a percentage of electricity from multiple sources, so if one cut out, they would have a backup. It's worth pointing out that Australia's power supply was highly reliable already, but a couple of highly publicised statewide blackouts in South Australia didn't exactly promote that fact. It also announced they would be scrapping subsidies and incentives for renewables. As the ABC put it,
"Instead, expecting retailers to ensure the power that they're buying is efficient enough to help Australia meet its international obligations."
Sure. At this point, the government was sticking to its 26 to 28% reduction on 05 levels by 2030, a phrase I'm very sick of saying. Now, the NEG only regulated emissions in regards to the energy sector, not the agricultural or transport or anything else. It sucked. However, within this garbage policy was a tiny detail. It had a built-in carbon price. The Sydney Morning Herald pointed out that the report read,
"Some electricity retailers will not be able to meet the required emissions profile, while others will overachieve. Therefore, a secondary exchange will occur between retailers to balance their portfolios."
So, if a retailer polluted too much under Turnbull's scheme, they could essentially purchase carbon credits from another retailer. So the difference between this scheme and the Gillard one was that the target was way worse, and instead of the government setting the price, the market would figure it out on its own. This was late 2017, but it didn't end up coming around to a vote until August of 2018, because politics just moves so slowly. But then the predictable happened. The coalition party room voted together and signed off on the proposal, except five hardcore right-wing MPs, led by Tony Abbott, who reserved their right to cross the floor and vote no. Other members, instead, just reserved their right to amend the bill during parliamentary debate. Of course, those five MPs would have been enough to ensure the bill didn't even pass the lower house. Turnbull said,
"You know, we have got to bring an end to the years of ideology and idiocy, which have been a curse on energy policy for too long. And that is why industry, whether you're talking about big industrial consumers or small business, consumer groups are calling on governments and oppositions to get behind this policy."
An end to the years of ideology. Turnbull essentially wanted the Labour Party to help him out in case those five MPs did leave. But the Labour Party wasn't about to do him a favour like that, and Turnbull couldn't risk losing a public vote like this, so he caved. Instead of putting up for a vote, he said his government would change regulations, which pissed off Tony and Co. even more. See, regulations don't require a vote in Parliament to be changed, so any future Labour government could then just change those regulations themselves. The NEG was dead, and so was Turnbull's prime ministership. The next day, he fended off a challenge from actual fascist Peter Dutton before being defeated by a spill motion with no specific challenger in mind. Essentially, he lost to an empty chair. To sum it up, Turnbull bad. His policies were weak and ineffective, but thanks to the shocking far-right bent of the modern coalition, even they were too much to handle. More so than that, even from beyond the political grave, Tony Abbott was still able to mess up the Australian response to climate change. Genuinely speaking, that man should be in jail. The empty chair would be replaced by Scott Morrison, or ScoMo, as I will not call him. In the last video I did on Aussie PMs, I talked about how the thing I'd always remember him for was for how hilariously badly he handled the issue of the Australian embassy in Israel. It's safe to say that after this summer, that's no longer the case. Years of rising temperatures, extreme drought, and critical underfunding for the fireys has just led to apocalyptic scenes. Leading up to this year, Morrison's climate policies have obviously been lacking. He kept the same garbage target as the previous governments. Still, he claimed we were meeting them in a canter. More on that later. Before the election, he renamed Abbott's Emission Reduction Fund, which had since run dry, the Climate Solutions Fund. He pledged $2 billion more for the fund. While we're here, let's talk about the effectiveness of this fund. Emissions Reduction Minister Angus Taylor called the ERF auction a milestone. Fantastic. Great move. Well done, Angus. Fun fact about the ERF, while Turnbull was in the political wilderness, he called it a recipe for fiscal recklessness. The ERF funds projects through a reverse auction. Businesses nominate how cheaply they can reduce emissions, and the cheapest bids are chosen by the government, who buy carbon credits from the projects once they verify their emission cuts. Think of it like this. A big farmer says he can switch 80% of his power to solar if the government can give him X hundred thousand dollars. The government accepts his bid, the farmer does so, and then the government pays them while giving itself a carbon credit equal to the cuts in emissions. That's the idea. The reality was that two-thirds of the money went to paying corporations to either revegetate land or avoid deforestation, essentially paying landowners to not clear their land. As in, I was going to cut down these trees for grazing land, but if you give me $10 million, I won't. This is the same kind of land clearance stuff that Australia took to Kyoto. Paying someone to not destroy carbon sinks is not the same as emission reductions. $300 million of public funding went to paying corporations to avoid deforestation. Because we couldn't have just, I don't know, legislated against them being able to do that, could we? At the announcement of the new funding, Morrison said,
"It's important to have a balance in your emissions reductions policies. You've got to have the cool head as well as the passionate heart. Our government will take, and is taking, meaningful, practical, sensible, responsible action on climate change without damaging our economy or your family budget."
Honestly, the reason I put so many quotes in this video was to show you how interchangeable they all are. That line from Morrison could easily have been said by Rudd, Gillard, any of them. Put simply, the rhetoric doesn't matter. It's all garbage. Anyway, the Morrison government has also made waves by suggesting that Australia eventually double its coal exports. Australia is already the third largest export of fossil carbon in the world. The coal and oil and gas that we export produces more than 1.1 billion tons of CO2 a year. This is more than double Australia's domestic emissions across all industries and fields. An oft-repeated claim by conservatives is that Australia is so small, we barely contribute to global warming, which is false already. But when you take into account our fossil fuel exports, 3.6% of all of the carbon emissions in the whole world come from Australia. 3.6%. Morrison wants to add to that. In December of last year, some countries complained that Australia was cheating on its Paris goals, as we're only going to meet them by counting the Kyoto land clearance allowances. That's right, those ones secured by the Howard government 24 years ago are still being counted by the Australian government today, when they were never reasonable to begin with. According to the Department of the Environment and Energy, if Australia was not taking these into account, we would only be on track to lower 16% of our emissions on 05 levels, which, as I've said many times, is a terrible marker. However, As of the 2nd of December last year, the independent scientific group, the Climate Action Tracker, reported this was not the case. They said that under the current policies, Australian emissions are headed for an increase of 8% above 05 levels, excluding land clearance. Personally, I believe the independent group of scientists more than I do the Australian Department of the Environment. Just saying. If every other country in the world was handling climate change the same way as us, we would be heading for a global temperature increase of 3 to 4 degrees Celsius by the year 2100. And unfortunately, enough countries are acting this poorly, or even worse. We are currently, as a planet, heading for that marker. And that's so bad. Since those reports, the fires have put climate change back on everyone's minds. You have no doubt seen how bad it is. At least 10.7 million hectares of land has burned so far, which is roughly the same size as all of South Korea. At least 27 people have died, 2,200 homes have burned down, roughly 1 billion animals perished. There's possible extinction of many of those. There's a smoke cloud the size of the entire Australian continent drifting around the world. Some 400 billion tons of carbon has been emitted just from these fires. And normally, when carbon burns off from a fire, it eventually comes back in because stuff grows back again. But it's so dry and it's so hot, we don't know how much is going to grow back, so... Personally, I've been fortunate. Where I live isn't too close to many of the fires. My loved ones have all largely been safe, which is a relief. The most we've had to deal with is a few days of smoke haze. But just waking up every morning and hearing about which parts of the country is burning, trying to take in as much news as possible, trying to stay informed, starts to take a toll. I can't imagine being someone who's lost a home or a loved one or has fought these fires, and my heart and respect goes out to them. And part of the reason it's so bitter is that we knew this would happen eventually. I still remember hearing about global warming for the first time in a classroom back in 2003. They said it would keep getting hotter, we would have more and more severe droughts, and therefore longer and worse fire seasons. 2019 was both Australia's hottest and driest year on record. The Bureau of Meteorology called this year's spring months the worst on record for fire danger, compared to their records that go back for 70 years. This country is a tinderbox, and so am I. On the 10th of January this year, in the middle of this crisis, as he was being pushed to recognise climate change as one of the causes of the fires, Scott Morrison said,
"We don't want job-destroying, economy-destroying, economy-wrecking targets and goals, which won't change the fact that there have been bushfires or anything like that in Australia. The suggestion there's any one emissions reductions policy or climate policy that has contributed directly to any of these fire events is just ridiculous, and the conflation of those two things, I think, has been very disappointing."
The government has responded with a package of money to rebuild burnt-down towns and homes, and change the rules about when we can send the army in to help with fires. They're considering a royal commission in the bushfires, which could end up touching on the climate, though I'm not holding my breath. I mean, I will be holding my breath if the smoke comes through again. That's just a little fire humour for you. Of course, if in and amongst all this, Morrison specifically refused to raise Australia's emissions target under the Paris Agreement. As of writing this script, that was announced yesterday. His atrocious handling of the fires, from going off to Hawaii, then pretending to not be in Hawaii, coming back and trying to distract us with the cricket, his astonishingly dehumanizing interactions with the victims, refusing to fund volunteer firefighters, and then flip-flopping and funding those after means-testing the hell out of them. Plus, whatever happens next in the 2 weeks I'm going to spend editing this video, it's been a disaster. Protests have popped up all around the country, and if you're an Australian, I urge you to find your nearest one. Uni Students for Climate Justice got 10,000 people in Adelaide last Friday, and closer to 30,000 in Melbourne. They are still, as of recording, organising new protests, so get out there and be counted. There's one clip that I think sums up the last decade better than any other. Listen to how then-PM Tony Abbott talks with Peter Dutton and Scott Morrison when they think they're not being recorded. For context, the term that Peter Dutton is going to use here, Cape York time, refers to the pretty racist idea that Indigenous people on Australia's Cape York are often late due to laziness. Tony Abbott will then respond that they had much of that up in Port Moresby, which refers to the recent climate talks with Pacific Island leaders in Port Moresby. And that's about all you need to understand this clip. Take it away, Pete.
Had your time.
That's his mate.
Had your time. Yeah, I tell you, we had a bit of that up in Port Moresby.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, it was a good meeting. It was a good meeting.
When was it Moresby?
Yeah, it was magnificent. We were about to be, you know, have water lapping at your place.
So the joke there is that our Pacific neighbours will soon be underwater thanks to climate change. They're laughing because they know it's the truth. Then they notice the microphone and button up. And that's the thing you need to remember. They know it's the truth. No matter how many of these denialist speeches or inflammatory comments they make, this mob completely understands that climate change is real, and they know it's coming for us all. They're just choosing to do nothing about it, because it's easier to do nothing than to confront the pitfalls of your own ideology. These are men with no interest in or capacity for introspection. These aren't good people who just believe differently to us. They are bad people who don't care. And they're just the latest in a long, long line of disinterested actors who have put their own economic record and electoral interests before the survival of our whole planet. This isn't something we can just procrastinate on and knock out in the last minute before complete ecological collapse. Every government we've ever had has failed us on this issue. Every single one. They all said climate change was a problem. But did any of them do anything? The best we ever got was a half-measure carbon price with built-in bailouts for giant companies. And when that was scrapped, emissions continued to rise. This isn't a liberal versus labour issue. It's a capital versus the world issue. None of these people are on your side. The system isn't on your side. If you're from another country, I urge you to do some of the same research on your own governments. Odds are you'll be just as pissed off as me. And please, heed our warning. It's not fun being the canaries in the coal mine. But we are. We can't just keep doing the same thing. Our lives are depending on it. All lives are depending on it. Now, at the start of this video, I mentioned that there's a feeling in the air, that something's got to give. But that's just the feeling. That's not the political reality. We have to work to make that happen. So what are some solutions then? I don't know. How about a wealth tax on all mining and fossil fuel executives? They've taken from the earth to pollute the air, and I don't think taking back a little bit is out of line. I'm not greedy though, so let's cap it at 95%. After all, 5% of Gina Rinehart's wealth would still leave her with $780 million of assets. How about we take that money and put it into protecting the environment, rehousing people and animals, and renewable energy? How about a different royal commission? This one into every government of the last 40 years to discover what they were saying to each other about global warming behind closed doors, because I bet it's a hell of a lot worse than what we've heard. How about a blanket ban on all deforestation, because we can't afford to lose anymore? How about nationalising all coal mining operations in Australia, then shutting them down in the most efficient manner while still taking care of the workers? How about prosecuting the people who knowingly and willingly led us to this point for profit or political gain? How about banning the use of private planes in Australia, confiscating the ones that are already here, and retrofitting those that are able into water bombers? How about breaking up News Corp so they can no longer spread their anti-climate propaganda? How about socialism instead of barbarism? Because that's where we're headed. Without radical climate action, there can be no action on the fires. For 40 years, Australian politicians have had the chance to do something, and they've failed repeatedly. The solution has to come from outside the system. You, yes, you watching this right now, have to be part of the solution. Go to a protest and bring your friends who wouldn't normally come. Explain to them what's going on. Tell them about the $29 billion in subsidiaries that the government paid fossil fuels companies last year. That's about $1,200 for every living Australian. Get them mad. Focus your own anger. Be a part of the solution. Only the harnessed power of people can solve this, because the government isn't going to do it for us. I'd like to end this video by pointing out that Australia has been home to civilization for at least 65,000 years. Human beings have only been vastly affecting the climate for a couple of hundred years, and it would be an unthinkable crime to let the latter erase the former. It's your duty to act so that it doesn't. Thanks for watching. Oh.